Le Mouvement Performing the City. It's a pleasure to see you here and to talk a little bit more in depth. Actually, by talking to the press these past weeks, I found out that our complex project is not so easy to explain and that there were many questions. And so I think each opportunity to speak about it is actually a great thing. We are not alone. It's me, Gianni Jetzer, and Chris Sharp as co-curators. But we have two of the artists who will be involved in Biel in the second movement. Just to tell you the dates of the second movement, being the most important event with 22 performances in the streets of Biel. It's from August 26th to August 31st. So if you can come to Biel, which is about an hour and a half from Basel, or like half an hour from Bern, it would be great to see you there. If you can only come one day, come on August 30th, because you can see all together, all three movements together. So that's the key date, so to say. The two artists who are involved in the second movement are Pablo Bronstein, to the far left, and Alexandra Pirici. It's great because both of them produce actually new work for Le Mouvement, and it's a great opportunity to have them here and to hear them talk about their work, about the projects, about their expectations, maybe about their fears. And in general, I think we're going to structure the panel like that, that Chris and I will present the curatorial concept behind Le Mouvement, and that in a second step, Pablo will present his project, the same for Alexandra, and that in the end, we're going to discuss all together. The artists have prepared questions for the curators, so they're going to grill us in public. And there are many matters more to discuss, as for example, the success of performance art. There's quite a bit of performance art in Basel too, with 14 rooms and last week Performance City. And it seems to be in the air, and I think it's interesting to explain what kind of performance we are doing and why it's so different from, for example, 14 rooms. But I'm gonna hand the microphone over to Chris, and he's gonna give you some first remarks about the curatorial concept of Le Mouvement.
Thanks, Johnny. Thanks for coming, great to be here. Just to say a few words about the movement, or Le Mouvement, this is the 12th edition of the Swiss Sculpture Exhibition, which has been happening since 1954. So this exhibition is older than Documenta. And often when I talk about it, I talk about it by saying it's like this, the Munster Sculpture Projects of Switzerland. It happens, generally speaking, every 5 to 10 years. And it is, traditionally speaking, a public sculpture exhibition. So, which means that a lot like Munster, there are interventions in public space with objects and sculptures, so on and so forth. But when Johnny and I were invited to compete for curating the exhibition, we found ourselves immediately questioning the relevance of public sculpture as such. And for us, it seemed like something that was, although we have a lot of respect for it, but something that needed to be questioned and was somehow inherently problematic by virtue of the fact that it tended to impose itself on public space and impose specific readings, while at the same time becoming this thing which people walk around or ignore, so on and so forth. So we immediately asked ourselves two questions, like what is public space and how does it function now? Above all, after we got this commission, after or during the Arab Spring, Occupy Wall Street, and then there was Istanbul, all these different activist movements which were deeply embedded in public space and questions of public space. And then there was a question of the immobility of the sculpture, of this thing which is imposed upon public space. And we decided to reduce it, the entire exhibition, to its most fundamental elements, which is the human body and public space itself. The human body in public space, the human body with other bodies, the materiality of the human body vis-a-vis the materiality of sculpture, one which is static, immobile, the other which is ephemeral and fleeting. So as such, one of the best ways to interrogate this subject was largely through dance, like performance as dance, dance in public space, one of the most ephemeral forms of public performance.
On the other hand, it was quite clear that the format is the Swiss Sculpture Exhibition. For us, it was important to stay true to the roots of the whole event because it has taken 11 times before us. And so we really wanted to create a link to what happened before. And so of course, everybody knows the story of Pygmalion, who had the dream to bring his sculpture alive. And that was pretty much a spark in the whole discussion that we had. We thought, what we want is, obviously there were other presentations of the body in movement. And even when we went back to the archive of the Swiss Sculpture Exhibition, we found two brilliant examples. You see to the far left, Karl Burkhardt, the dancer. In the middle, Max Biel, Rhythm in Space. Both of those sculptures were shown in the very first edition of the Swiss Sculpture Exhibition in 1954. And obviously, both of them had the intention to make movement and physical movement, and in one case, even the body within physical movement as the main subject of their work. What is interesting is that it shows that it was a subject matter also in sculpture, like body movement and the identification of the viewer with a moving body, but that in this very first edition, there were like very different presentations of the body or of this rhythm in space. So there was an abstract presentation and figuration next to each other. So for us, it was clear that the first movement, and that's why we made it so complicated with the three movements, the first movement would be about getting sculptures alive or waking them up. Just quickly, if I could show that question, we formulated the question for each movement. And the one for movement one is, how does the permanence of sculpture relate to the transient materiality of the living body? And so we actually took these existing sculptures. So this is the first example. And we added Ariana Raines, New York writer and performance artist. And we invited her to do a performance relating to Max Biel and Karl Burkhardt. And actually have a contemporary female artist reacting to these two sculptures, but also stating her own artistic identity out of her interest.
And with the second one, what you see here, we paired Italian Paris-based artist Alex Cicchetti with a work by Olivier Mosset from the 10th edition from 2000, which was curated by Marc-Olivier Wallel. And what you're looking at on the right is the plinth to a sculpture by Aristide Maillol in Paris, in the Tuileries. And what Olivier did was recreate the plinth without the sculpture. And so you have this plinth without the sculpture, and then we pair Alex, and I think this is one of the most, say, perfect representations of the Pygmalion moment, in the sense that perhaps Alex could have walked off the plinth and become the sculpture.
The next example is by Christian Jankowski, a well-known German artist who always refers to other professionals to help him to realize works. For example, magicians or others. He did this very beautiful work earlier this year, Heavyweight History, where actually he had gymnasts in Warsaw, Poland, lifting up public monuments, quite heroic monuments, and they would just lift them up for a couple of seconds and let them down to the floor again. So the sculpture turns into a gym or a weight that you can lift and that you can train with. So he's gonna do an open air gym, going after all the public sculpture, like some of the public sculptures in Biel. And that was a cooperation with the Swiss Sports Academy that is in Macklingen, just above Biel. And so we have a parkour of different gymnastic exercises that can be done. There will be a little booklet that also reflects actually the publication of the previous sculpture exhibition, because he uses pages from out there and adds the the exercise with the instruction how to do it. So everybody is invited to use this parkour by themselves and to touch the sculptures, to get really close to them, to lie on top of them. But nevertheless, we're going to publish the page of the catalog, also to give some extra information about the work and the artists, mostly artists who have been a little bit forgotten, not in all cases, but in some cases at least.
Now we're moving into the second movement, which, as Gianni already said, I think, opens on August 26th and runs to August 31st. This is kind of the core of the exhibition. This is moving from like this Pygmalion movement to like just focusing on the body itself. And I should state that we've tried to simplify things as much as possible. And working with the artists, we've really discouraged the use of costume and props and tried to make it as pedestrian as possible. So the question we're starting with this one is, given the increasing regulation of every aspect of urban life, can public space still be said to exist? So this is a question that inevitably rises in a kind of neoliberal society. Is public space changing or is it been completely occupied by private space, as it were? This is an image by Lin Yulin that he performed in San Francisco in 2011, and which he rolled along the ground in different parts of the city and had it documented. And for Le Mouvement, he's going to be renewing this performance, let's say, and he will be rolling three different times on the ground from different parts of Biel, Bienne, always towards the mayor's house. And this is, with the exhibition in general, one thing we've really tried to do is approach the subject of the body and the materiality of the body and the codes which govern it in public space from different angles. So for instance, this is one where the body is on the ground, right? This is probably one of the biggest taboos of the body in public space, is being on the ground. It's like, it's not an acceptable form of locomotion, right, to roll along the ground. So it's really interesting in that respect.
I mean, Chris, you mentioned dance before. There are like certain artists who are more present in the dance performance world than in the art world, although Maria Hassabi is actually in both. She's this Greek performance artist living in New York since many years. This piece is an existing piece. One has to say about half of the performances are newly produced and half is existing, but adapted to the context of Biel, Bienne. So show is all about slowing down movement. So it's holding poses for a very long time. Actually, one source of inspiration for the first work and choreography of this type for Maria Hassabi was, again, Aristide Maillol and his kind of exaggerated poses for women who, like in sheer ecstasies, are hanging over the cliff of the plinth. And actually, she holds those poses for several minutes, although they are very spectacular because of the tension and the strength of the position taken in. And all of a sudden, she shifts into another position together with her dance partner to hold it again for several minutes. And so it's actually a freezing down of movement. It's a slowing down of public life to a certain extent, but it's also a claiming of space. Because a lot of movements in public space are actually transition movement, where people enter the space, but obviously they're going to also exit it. And here there's a long-lasting element that plays a very important role.
Yeah, I would say this piece is one of the more sculptural works, as it were, in the exhibition, in that, as Gianni said, it slows it down so much that it takes on like this sculptural quality. And really kind of reveals, let's say, the materiality of the body. Just as with this work by this classic piece by Simone Forti Huddle, the Italian California-based choreographer who was integral to Judson Dance Theater in the 60s, This is a classic piece from 1961 in which I'm sure half of you, if not all of you, have seen this in some form, where it's an improvisational piece where the basic idea is that a group of people hug one another and a dancer breaks off from the group and has to climb over the body of dancers, and this repeats. And I think as a visitor seeing this kind of thing, this is another work which emphasizes the materiality of the body in a different way, in the sense that you identify with the bodies being climbed on, with this idea that there's a knee in your back or an elbow in your head or something like that, and you have to maintain this.
And the last example is by Willy Dorner, an Austrian choreographer with a company on his own. He's very busy. He made this intervention, Bodies in Urban Space, many times in these past years. Here we see an example from Marseille. And actually, it's a form of observation. They track down the city and are looking for negative space or positive spaces that could be potential docking stations for this body of bodies. And he just docks himself, or they dock all this body to the city, and are kind of a living extension to architecture, but they also very often use gaps where they infiltrate the gap with their bodies. And it's a bit the key and keyhole situation, where they bring a functionality of the body that is totally different from movement, for example.
And lastly, we'll just say a few words about the third and final movement, which is called The City Performed. So this is an exhibition which we'll be taking at the local museum in Biel, Bienne, called the Kunsthaus Centre Pascal. And for this, we've tried to create a survey which historically contextualizes what we're doing. So performance in public space, dance in public space. Here with this first example, you see a work by Alberto Greco, kind of Argentine proto-conceptualist who was active in the early 60s. And he did these series of performances called Vivo Ditos, where he would see somebody in the street, draw a circle around them, and then sign it as if it were this kind of human living sculpture.
A famous body of work are the Körperkonfigurationen by Austrian artist Vali Export. I mean, there are many great examples of public art by Vali Export. For us, it was important to strip it down just to the sheer presence of the body in the city. She has chosen actually those buildings very cautiously, and they are like public buildings. They have a functions. I mean, it goes from the library to the police headquarters and so on. Of course, it's a work that has a strong connotation regarding a feministic practice, because in the 70s, when she did that work, female artists had a very different position from today. So it was very much also questioning the female body in action and the artistic identity, but not within the context of an art institution, but rather on the street.
And I think we can end here, so because we want to give some time to the artists to be able to talk. But this is a work, a photo of a work by Anna Halprin, who many of you probably know. This is one of the most important precursors of postmodern photography, based in San Francisco. And this is a massive project which she did in San Francisco in 1977 called City Dance, where she organized with this group of dancers a kind of citywide dance that started at dawn in San Francisco and ended at dusk. And they kind of danced across the city in this group, and sometimes spectators joined them. But it was one of these things where, again, it was, I think it's very, very relevant to our exhibition insofar as that it was very pedestrian. I mean, costumes or not, they're dressed kind of every day and just occupying public space in this way. But yeah.
And maybe Rikita Avenit as a last image in the exhibition. So it's pretty much, I think, the main element of the movement is really to question public space or what's left from it. I think we would rather tend to be pessimistic about the existence of public space, and so maybe there is an almost utopian element in Le Mouvement to kind of try to trigger it. For us, what we want to try is really to make it a movement in the city of Biel between August 26th and 31st, and to put like all action and all movement that are taking place in public space under suspicion, so to say, and to change actually the perception of movement and the codification of movement by infiltrating like different forms of movements and different forms of functioning. Maybe the most extreme example is by Sean Keller, Swiss artist. His project, he wants to spend the whole 5 days or the whole 6 days in public space, and he wants to see if he can get arrested, but not by breaking the law, but rather by an overuse or an inappropriate use of public space, like playing against the rule rather of society than the laws. But nevertheless, the police would have to arrest him. And we guaranteed him that we as curator would defend him in court in case he would have to show up there.
Yeah, and at this point, I think we should hand the microphone over to Pablo. It would be great if you could just discuss your contribution to Le Mouvement and contextualize it in your practice.
Sure. Is this on? Can you hear? Yeah. Stop me when I run out of time, because I could just go on. Really, the performance derived from a working process with a dancer that I used for an exhibition in Red Cat in Los Angeles. There's an image of it up here. This isn't the dancer that will be taking part, but essentially, this dancer rehearsed my piece in a way that no other dancer has ever worked with me before. What they did was essentially to micro-correct, micro-break up emblems that I'm used to working with. What I start with is an idea of sprezzatura that I form in my head. It's not a fantastically rigorous historical discourse, this idea of sprezzatura. Sprezzatura is essentially a kind of art of elegance, of physical comportment. And so, for example, Western art is littered with it. There's the hands of the Mona Lisa, which are like this. There's endless statues that sort of point or die. It's all about serpentine forms and, the body in a constant, elegant motion that doesn't betray physical effort. So it's really about working very hard to look like you're not working very hard. And essentially, what we will do for this, it's set on a balcony. She has a balcony. The dancer Rebecca Bruner has a balcony on the fifth floor of a very, very wonderful fin de siècle, sort of eclectic neoclassical building. She stands on the balcony, facing a public square, and she goes through a sort of ABC of sprezzatura poses. Now, sprezzatura in the context of Pygmalion is actually quite useful because essentially the poses are derived from Western art. They could be famous pictures, they might not. They could be also classical ballet. You know, there's endless amounts of positions that are very sprezzatura-esque. So she will go from A to B to see of these different sorts of positions, but the way she will get there is through a breaking up of this smooth elegance, of this ease that dancers are normally trained to arrive at. So, for example, with a classical ballet, or with Baroque ballet very often, if you want to point, you may point through the center of the chest and up. It's less elegant to just do that, you know. So this sense of arriving at somewhere slowly is something that we will take as a starting point and then fracture the way that she's fractured my rehearsals in the past. So, and by fracture, I mean that she constantly corrects her position. I mean, it seems almost neurotic. The reason for this is that I became interested in this idea of how much movement we perceive of people at a distance. So when you're sort of very up close to someone, I mean, I can see your fingers twitching, I can see the sort of ins and outs of how Gianni's scribbling with his pen. But from afar, people at the back of the room, I can see maybe large movements of the head, you know, bigger movements of the, but I can't see the flickering of the eyelids. I mean, it sounds extremely obvious, but it underlies the way that we make abbreviations about people's movements in public. Normally in private, we don't have that sort of large distance. Public space is still the place when the street is still the place where we can most see people at a distance. And so the idea is to fracture this elegant ABC of sprezzatura to the point where if you are within the piazza, you will perceive her movement as continuous. And the closer you get, the more fractured this movement will seem. Right. I'm done with this image. I think we can just... Yeah. I think... Yeah. So the title is Girl on a 19th Century Balcony. What I really wanted to say about that, well, the last thing really to say about that is that the title contains both an extremely dry way of describing an artwork. It's very 60s in a way, you know, person on chair sort of artwork. But it's also got a kind of romantic Western art association with balconies, with watching people in public space. She's, of course, within a private space, but visible from the public space, and the sort of sexuality that takes place within that, the Goya painting of the Maya Machas on the balcony and so on. There's a history of sex being sold within this relationship, this long-distance relationship in public. I'm done with that.
That's great. Thank you so much. I have one quick question. You often work with classical architecture in your work, and you've done a lot of different pieces with dance and classical architecture. I wonder if you could just say a few words about the relationship between the two.
The relationship isn't necessarily a logical one. I mean, it's important for me to say that I'm not a choreographer. I'm also not a dance historian, and I'm not an architect. And so when I talk about classical architecture or architecture in general, it is as an image within my visual universe rather than as something that is particularly externally validated. I would say that the relationship, as far as this project is concerned, is about the breaking down of the pedestrian system. In other words, I'm very interested in sprezzatura because what it does is it brings in a coherent system from the 19th, 18th, especially the 17th century, and says this is what we used to consider normal, everyday behavior. You know, to lift your glass like this was okay. I mean, there are some, I'm imagining that there are some sort of syphilitic courts in northern Italy that were very mannered as they reached for their glasses, and there are probably some slightly more straight, Viking-y, 17th century sprezzaturas that were a little bit more blokey, you know. But the idea is that this is a system that was in widespread use for 300-400 years, and it was considered everyday behavior in its time. The way that, for example, people assume that pedestrian behavior is sit down however the fuck you want, wear your jeans, and chill out. Flat feet on the floor. That is, of course, learned behavior. There is nothing intrinsically, genetically more human to do that than to pick up your teacup like that. You know, you pick up your teacup however you pick it up. There is no right way to do it. And so sprezzatura is an analogous language. to the pedestrian. It's a sort of parallel one that's rooted in history, that is dead as a system. And for me, classical architecture very often behaves in the same way. It's a system that evokes a different kind of order, a different kind of idea of civility, of the public, of commerce, of whatever you want. It dresses itself up in a different language. It's a parallel to the way we currently live. It influences the way we visualize democracy, but it's not. It doesn't quite fit. It's not a true ongoing tradition. There's been a fracture.
Great, thank you so much. Can we move to the PDF, please? I guess at this point, I'm going to ask you the same question, Alexandra. If you could speak about your contribution to Le Mouvement and contextualize it, be great.
Yeah, I don't know if we should wait, but in the meantime, I can maybe say a few words. I think when you sent the curatorial statement for the exhibition, I kind of realized that it also merged very well with the previous interest that I had in sculpture in public space. And I actually make these sculptural interventions or additions to public space monuments, which it would be nice maybe to... can we go to the first image? Yes. So yes, basically I work with performers. They don't have to be necessarily trained performers, or they can also be regular people. And I started basically with adding these living sculptures to city monuments. I realized it was very interesting to be part of your project because I had the same interest in the materiality of the immaterial, actually, and of the body all the qualities that you can have with this kind of material in relation to public space monuments in general and to the materiality of public space monuments and sculptures, and which are usually very solid, very heavy. It's either stone or bronze. They're meant to be permanent. They're meant to be impermeable and inflexible. And I was reading this Rosalind Deutsche text about the public space being somehow inherently conflictual as long as you can still claim that it is public, because it means that it's still in negotiation. And she was giving this example of this Richard Serra sculpture, tilted arc, that used to almost block a square in Manhattan, and it triggered very very aggressive reactions from the public, actually, and from the people who are passing by. And these reactions got it removed in the end from the public space. So it was this huge arc of steel. And I was then interested in just maybe reperforming Richard Serra's sculpture, but with a different kind of material. To see how this would actually transform the work. And it's also part of my interest with this practice of enactment. For example, here these performers are enacting the horse. That's an equestrian sculpture of Carol I in Bucharest. And we decided to add this small army of actually horses, because for me it was a better way to identify with a contemporary citizen, or the contemporary status of the citizen. And if we can move on to the next. Oh, you're doing, sorry, I was just. This is a monument of revolution, of rebirth in Bucharest. It's the monument of revolution of 89. I don't think I should go into details about the significance or the content of the works, but we are performing this, now we are basically enacting this pike and moving with its shadow gradually over 3 hours. These public space interventions we did for a period of 3 weeks every day, for a couple of hours every day. So I was also looking for a kind of permanence because of the impermanence or of the ephemerality of the body. So I was trying to prolong it as long as possible. And that is why also somehow I'm interested in calling these works sculptures, because I'm interested in working with this reference and within this convention of sculpture. And I think it's very different when you come with the expectation to see a performance. And also in the case of this enactment of the tilted arc, which would be like a human tilted arc, I think it's important that people do not come and expect a spectacle. And I mean, of course, because it's made of people, it can react, but it will react only if it's acted upon. So it's not really delivering any spectacle without being engaged. So actually, this practice of enactment is something that was interesting for me to bring into the gallery and the museum space. But of course, it has a kind of a different connotation. But I will just ask you to go quickly through these images. Last year, I did this project, an immaterial retrospective of the Venice Biennale, together with a fellow artist, Manuel Pelmus. We did the Romanian pavilion at the Venice Biennale, and we asked performers to perform for the whole duration of the Biennale, so for 6 months, every day, 8 hours a day, two groups, to perform artworks, to enact artworks or significant events, or maybe even anonymous artworks or less known events from the history of the Biennale since 1895 till the edition last year. And this is Joseph Beuys' work, Tram Stop, A Monument to the Future. Maybe we can go to the next. This is Marcel Duchamp, L-A-O-O-Q, Mona Lisa with Moustache. Again, maybe this is more interesting also in terms of transforming from one medium to another. But another aspect that is also interesting for me, and especially in the public space with the pub and this idea of public space monument, is the way that the human scale and the human body placed next to this construction usually descales it or demonumentalizes it or reveals it as a construction. Maybe it would have been better to say that before when we had the previous images, but I think, this is also an interest of mine, like how you can descale and demonumentalize structures. And it can be a monument in public space, but it can also be, for example, the institution of the Venice Biennale. It's a different kind of monumentality, but...
I think it's also interesting its relationship to ideology, yeah. Right?
Yes.
The way public sculpture kind of solidifies or... hardens ideology as if this is something that's not going to change, or something like this responds to the kind of current unacceptability of different forms of ideology.
And I think there is also a very basic and general transcultural, transnational obsession with size, which is still, it expresses itself in different ways, but from like the pyramids to skyscrapers, you still have this idea of power that expresses itself visually through size. And that's why sometimes I think it's just a matter of framing the right things and like framing human bodies in relation to these huge constructions to sort of like reveal them for what they are. This is Felix Gonzalez Torres' work. It was creating more a situation initially. So the original work is a black licorice candy carpet. Okay, we can move on. This is actually from, I have very bad photos, from a rehearsal. We did this work for an art fair for FIAC last year. And again, we worked with enactment, and I was working with Manuel Pelmus again, and what we were doing was enacting artworks, the most expensive that were on sale at the art fair, and trying to sell them cheaper. So this was our enactment of Anselm Kiefer work. We can
That's see. Great. I think maybe we should stop here, because we're nearing the end.
Oh, okay. Okay.
If you want to say.
Maybe we can go through this very fast, because I wanted to... Yeah, this is at FIAC, is Jeff Koons. And maybe we can reach the end images. This is at Pompidou. We're working with the history of the Centre Pompidou, a Richard Serra work. Again, and this is in Leipzig at this huge monument, the Battle of Nations, and I did this also sculptural additions to this very big, huge.
Maybe massive. You could talk a little bit more about, I mean, it's certainly not easy to replace a tilted arc by human bodies, and to, I mean, obviously there was a lot, you mentioned it, there were a lot of aggressive reactions towards it. And like, how will you transpose, or like, I mean, there must be a type of translation from this metal like element and from the height. I mean, although you can find very tall performers, but how will you, or will you try at all to compete with the original, or will you resolve it in a different way?
I think it's a little bit of both, but of course it would be resolved in a different way, because of course you would not have the height, and you don't have this materiality of Sarah's work. But I think I'm more like trying to create this like to block also the space. But it's something that can be, that you can go through actually. If you ask for passage, you would be let through. So again, you know, human bodies in public space are smart material, you know, that you can negotiate with, they're flexible.
I think it's very beautiful because somehow it turns into a monument because the original has vanished, you know, and it's one of the most prominent losses, I guess, in public art in the 20th century. It's quoted everywhere. It's in every book about public art and the failure of public art. But I think it's very beautiful because it's kind of a temporal monument to this work that is so heavy and so loaded with history.
Yeah, kind of homage.
Yeah, well, the works are not intended to be only critical, so I think I try to do more than that, maybe. So
I think what you said is also interesting about blocking public space. And then again, just like Sarah in a way, although it'd be interesting to consider the differences, but in blocking public space, you kind of reveal it, you know, you disclose it in a way.
I think we should do a jump cut because Claudio from Art Basel had the brilliant idea to ask the artists to prepare questions for us. And actually the questions are so good that I think it would be a pity not to ask them and not to discuss them. And so maybe we should just jump, and maybe Pablo, you want to start?
Yeah, I actually wrote it down because it's so long, I'm sorry. Okay, so I think it's directly about how you will curate the show. In other words, there's public space that reads privately. And there's private space that reads publicly in visual terms. I mean, we know of lots of piazzas that have, of course, public associations, and we find them in shopping malls, in privately owned squares, and all sorts of places that are clearly private spaces, and yet the visual aspect is one of public. That's, of course, a cynical architectural ploy in order to very often get us to feel at home somewhere that they want us to come into, or they feel they have ownership of, but they want us to feel we have ownership of as citizens. So knowing that there's this sometimes misleading appearance to public and private space, are you more interested in the aesthetic of publicness within the exhibition, or with actual politically accurate public space?
That is a great question. I think both, but I think when it comes down to it, we're more interested. I mean, I guess it's a less cynical response. We're more interested in testing whether or not public space exists. And when we think of public space, I think we're thinking of public space as a verb as opposed to a noun, right? This public space is this thing which is inherently uncertain, which can't be stabilized or defined, which is characterized by its fundamental instability. So I think when we introduce bodies as opposed to sculptures into public space, again, there is the sense of instability and uncertainty, right, that kind of goes throughout the exhibition. So I think that it's more the latter, but again, I guess to a certain degree, we are interested inevitably in the aesthetics of public space. But yeah, I'm sorry, I think we're going to have to wrap up here.
But I think the Pablo, unfortunately, has to catch a plane, so probably you're going to leave us now, but maybe we should just use up the the last 8 minutes that we have and go on with Alex. And thank you so much, Pablo.
Thanks so much,
please,
Pablo.
Please give him a warm applause for his tight schedule. And I mean, I reach a point where I think that probably public space never existed. It was more kind of a utopian content, maybe a way to orientate certain functional spaces of the city. But I think eventually I can't really believe in the notion of public space. And as I said previously, I think it's very interesting to try to trigger a certain intensity of public life and to breaking the rules and to breaking the habits of a city. And I think it's also quite a change to do it in Biel rather than in New York or in Zurich, because Biel has a size that has almost a model character. It's not too large, it's not too little, it's not too aggressive, like the pedestrian zone is still kind of a pedestrian zone. It has a lot of changes, like the Thursday afternoon looks totally different from Saturday afternoon, and Sunday is a day that has much less street activity because all the stores are closed. So like, actually there are a lot of parameters that change every day, and I think that would be also quite interesting to see how this alters certain performances that get repeated. But Alex, you kind of prepared a long question, and I think it's long for a reason, because it's kind of complex and manifold, and I would like you to ask it again.
Okay, I will try. Actually, yeah, it's kind of a more general concern. And it was interesting also because you make an exhibition of actually time-based performative works instead of a sculpture exhibition. And I'm also wondering, you know, what are your thoughts, for example, on this not so recent but quite recent hype of performance within the art world? And because I see it very much connected with this economy of the event and the economy of attention. And I think it's, of course, it's, in a way, it's quite a good marketing strategy, and this is, I think, probably the reason that major art institutions and art fairs started to introduce performance programs, because they also respond better to the contemporary subjectivity and the change in attention span of the contemporary subjectivity than objects. So there was this need to stimulate and to animate exhibitions. And I get, for example, a lot of proposals to present or like to make something for the openings, you know, so not for a longer period, but for the openings. And I think it definitely has this quality of, you know, of animating of, I was interested in how do you see performance now, whether you think of it in these romantic terms also, like in the 60s and the 70s, where it had this maybe... it was said to have a subversive potential, and I'm going, it's a long question indeed. Because, for example, artists used to perform themselves. They would use their own bodies, you know, because they would subvert this this production. But now, for example, the body of the artist becomes the body of the celebrity. And, you know, they didn't, in the performance artists in the 60s also, they resorted to selling objects, actually, and documentation of the work. So I'm more interested in how do you see the role of performance art today, or how do you find it subversive, if it's,
I think we are kind of privileged to be invited to the Swiss Sculpture Exhibition and to keep the roots alive, you know, and to have maybe the figure walking away of the pedestal, but not totally leaving it. And I think we had a lot of restriction in our curatorial concept by really trying to keep it very real and to make it possible for the visitors to encounter the performers on eye level and standing on the same ground. So that's a very important point for me, that actually hopefully a lot of situations will get suspicious during those days in Biel, you know, and hopefully there will be everyday situation like turning maybe into art or like confusing people or making them reconsider what is going on. And I think what is really interesting is like of course, we are living in the society of spectacle, and everybody's asking for more events and more things, more live things to happen. But I think it doesn't really apply to spectacle what we are offering, because it's very much underwhelming concerning the narratives, concerning of costumes, concerning of stages, concerning of reading, I don't know, dreams or like maybe cliches within figures. It's everything is kind of unpacked to the most basic of performance. It's pretty much about the presence of physical body. And we also come back to this idea of dance, of being an organizational form to negotiate community, you know? And we want to broaden that up and actually make even encounters of one performer and one passerby as kind of a negotiation of community and of using of the same space in an almost archaic way, you know, where you kind of claim space or maybe you step back and where you start to feel what physical presence is and what movement is and what you can express through it.
Oh, that's great. So we have to end it here. We've run out of time. It'd be so great to be able to discuss these questions more, but anyhow, thank you so much, Alexandra.
Thank you.
And thank you for hosting us, for coming.
Thank you very much.